Good morning. Welcome. Those of you who read the weekly email will already know, but in 3 weeks' time, Sunday, February 27th, we have our annual general meeting. We're going to hold it on Zoom because we'd like as many people as possible to be there, especially if you're watching the video online. We have missed your smiling face, so it'd be great if you logged in too. The link for the Zoom meeting will be sent out to everyone on the mailing list that morning. So if you're not on the mailing list, let me know and I'll make sure that you're included in that link. I sent out the annual report for 2021 to all of the members this week, but if you're not a member and you'd like to have a copy, let me know and I can send that to you as well. The report is a really good opportunity to look back on what's happened during the year. When I came to write my report, I suddenly thought, I don't know where the year started and where it ended, because it just feels like it's been a couple of years of COVID and protocols and in and out. But it was good to look back and just remind myself of what we've come through and how amazing God's grace is, which brings us very nicely to our first song, where we're going to be singing about this is amazing grace. And one of the lines in here really strikes home with me. It says, who brings our chaos back into order? And I'm someone who really likes order, and this year has not always been a time of order. There's been lots of chaos. So I'm very relieved that my God will bring the chaos back into order. It's all okay. So I'd invite you to stand with me and let's praise God and his amazing grace.
Well, good morning. Once again, my assistant bringing the snowman up on the table for us. Thank you, Ian. I'm just going to show them real quick because I think you guys are a little bit parallel to it, Hannah and Grace and Emily, so you can have a little quick look. In case you haven't been able to track along with us, we're looking at different personalities in the Bible, and we're looking for ways that maybe we are kind of like that person and what's to learn from them and maybe what's to be a little bit cautious about, or what we can avoid if possible. So, Gemma, my helper this morning, just noticed, she said, yeah, they're all different shapes, and even their buttons are the same shape. I don't know if you guys have been noticing that little detail, but there you go, we'll point it out for you. So our snowman, our Bible character today is Thomas. My grandmother was born and named Mabel, okay? And she did not like her name. She didn't like her name because there was a skipping rope rhyme that went, Mabel, Mabel, set the table. And she got told that all the time. Mabel, Mabel, set the table. She was a very strong woman. And when she became an adult, she officially changed her name. She gave it a Southern flair and she called herself Maybell because she didn't like that little rhyme. And you know, sometimes there are things attached to a name. Sometimes they're positive. Most of the time they're kind of negative if you've heard them before. And I just thought of a couple. Raising Cain, if you've heard that phrase before, I don't know. Raising Cain, and it's not like the Cain you use, it's C-A-I-N, the person. And if someone is raising Cain, it's they're causing trouble, because Cain did a little bit of that, so we can read about him another time. Another name is Pollyanna. Have you heard that one? Don't be a Pollyanna, and that's someone who's maybe overly cheerful, and overly positive about something, maybe not dealing in reality, and they'll say, she's such a Pollyanna. Well, this morning, our guy, Thomas, has a phrase attached to his name, and you've probably heard it. People will say, don't be a doubting Thomas, or she's a doubting Thomas. So Thomas kind of got labeled with this a little bit unfairly, I think, but because there were other really good parts of what we see of him in the Bible, and it wasn't just that one time. And maybe we'll even be able to sort of understand him a little bit better when we look at, in the Gospel of John, he wrote a little bit more about Thomas than the other Gospels did. He was one of the disciples, and what we're going to see about Thomas is that he liked to watch and listen. So remember, you're going to kind of look to see if maybe this sounds a little bit like you. And Thomas needed to understand how things work. That was what he was like. So one of the times that we have Thomas actually quoted in the Bible is when Jesus says, I'm going back to heaven, I'm going to make a place for you there. I'm going to my Father's house, and my Father's house are many rooms, and I'm going to go and prepare a place for you. And then I'm going to come back and I'm going to take you with me. And Jesus says, I will come back and take you to be with me that you may be where I am. You know the way to the place where I am going. Well, there stood Thomas. He was listening and he needed to understand. And he said, Lord, we don't know where you're going. So how can we know the way? That was a good question. He wasn't doubting Jesus in that moment. He was just saying the obvious. There were so many times when Jesus would tell his disciples something, they didn't understand what he meant. They didn't understand what he was saying because it was really new stuff. And Thomas just said, well, we don't know where you're going. How can we know the way? And the answer to that from Jesus is one of the really favorite verses of a lot of people because Jesus said, I am the way. And the truth and the life. So we can thank Thomas for getting that answer recorded because it's a favorite of quite a few people, including me. Well, then, as you know, Jesus was crucified, so he died, and he was buried, and the disciples were really sad. they did not think he was coming back to life, okay? Even though he'd given them hints, they didn't understand what he was saying. And so the disciples were really discouraged. They'd been following him, and they didn't understand how he could die. And then what were they supposed to do? Well, they were gathered together, all of them except Thomas, or at least Thomas was one of the two that wasn't with them. And I'm wondering if Thomas was off thinking by himself, because a person with this personality often likes to be alone and think about things on their own. And Jesus appeared to the disciples, and then they saw Thomas, and they said, "He's alive. We saw Jesus." And this is where Thomas gets his little moniker, Doubting Thomas, because he said, "Unless I see the prints in his hands, the nail prints, and I can touch them, and I can put my hand in his side, I don't believe it." And some of us can sort of understand that, right? It was pretty crazy to think somebody who they had seen die was alive again just 3 days later, or this may have been a few days after that he appeared to them. So that's why people say he's a doubting Thomas. But I love the end of that, because if you can picture this, the disciples are in a room, the door's closed, Thomas is with them, and Jesus walks through the wall and appears to them. Can you imagine? If we had all these doors shut and Jesus came in, it would be pretty freaky, wouldn't it? And Jesus says to Thomas, "Thomas, put your hands in the nail prints of my hands, and put your hand through my side, in the scar of my side, and then you will believe." And we don't know for sure if Thomas did it. It doesn't say that he did, but what he did say is, "My Lord and my God." So he believed. Okay? So I think that's such a redeeming thing for Thomas. He wasn't a bad person, because he had to study things, he had to think about them before he would agree. That's okay. That's a good thing. And I have a little scenario that I, you know, just drew up in my mind that maybe would be what would happen with kids. Let's say you're hanging out with your friends and they say, "I know what we should do. Let's build a treehouse." And some of the other kids are getting excited about it. "Yeah, let's have a treehouse. That'd be so cool." And maybe you're sitting there and you're quiet and you're thinking. And maybe you have a friend who says, "Don't you want to do this? What's wrong? Don't you want to be excited with us?" But what you're doing, if you have a personality that listens and watches and has to understand how things work, maybe you're looking at the trees that they're pointing at and thinking, "Okay, that one's too high. If we built the treehouse up there and we fell, probably break an arm. That one has a dead limb. That's probably not a good tree to use. Probably want to use that tree." And then you hear them saying, "Oh yeah, we'll get some wood. I've got some wood at my house." And maybe you're thinking, "We're going to have to cut that wood. Probably going to need a saw. We're probably going to need a parent or somebody to help us, because we're not going to be allowed to use a saw." And then you hear them say, "Oh, we'll put a roof on it." And then you're thinking, "Oh, well, that means walls. Walls are pretty tricky, a little bit harder than a platform." So if this is you and you're thinking, "Yeah, that's what I do. When I see an idea or hear an idea, to think through, how is it going to work?" And you know what I'm here to say to you? We need you. We need you to think through that, because I'd probably be one of those people going, "That's a great idea. Let's do it. Fun." And then I need to hear from the Thomas type personality, who says, "Okay, let's think this through. Make sure we've got it safe. Make sure it makes sense," and all those good things. So the thing you want to watch for, if you're a personality like this, is that a personality like this will often choose to be alone. They like their own company. They like to read and study and think about things on their own, and that's okay too. But I just want to remind you that sometimes you might need to push yourself to be with people, both for your good, but also for our good, because we need those thinkers to do that, to show us the other side of things, okay? So that's Thomas. That's our snowman for this week. Thank you very much.
Good morning. Please join me in saying the Lord's Prayer. Our Father in heaven, may your name be kept holy. May your kingdom come soon. May your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today the food we need and forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Don't let us yield to temptation, but rescue us from the evil one. The kingdom, the power, and the glory belong to you forever. Amen. Let's continue in prayer. In these days of conflict, both here and abroad, Lord, open our eyes to your magnificence, that we see everything you have done for us. Help people see and know that you alone are the way forward, that your love for us builds bridges, and our love for you keeps us on the right path. Thank you, Lord. In these days of conflict, both here and abroad, Lord, please help us to show each other grace and respect, to see each other as mirrors of ourselves rather than adversaries. Help us communicate our needs and be available to listen and respond with love. In these days of conflict, both here and abroad, Lord, please help our leaders care for the people they represent with wisdom, where people can feel valued, appreciated, and heard, where decisions are made that will support them and their neighbors. In these days of conflict, both here and abroad, Lord, please help first responders support and keep them safe on their daily walk of maintaining the peace and health of people around them. Give them continued wisdom and caring hearts. In these days of conflict, both here and abroad, Lord, please help your people that suffer from loss and illness. Help them feel closer to you and feel your supporting hands carry them through their darkest days and every day beyond. In these days of conflict, both here and abroad, Lord, please help our hearts. Help us know deep down that we are truly loved for who we are and not for what we do. And help us see days of love both here and abroad. In these days of love, both here and abroad, Lord, thank you for your unconditional love, for your Son, Jesus Christ, who gave his life for us, each one of us, and for your Holy Spirit who walks with us every day. May your will be done. In Jesus' precious name, amen.
Last week we talked about the type personality that needs to be special. We talked about the kind of person that goes deep and dark and is dramatic and artistic. And you know, the history of the church has allowed for a lot of the experience of that kind of personality. So today we're going to look at another one, which is almost the opposite, because the one we'll think about today, as Mary has introduced, is a person who is just a facts kind of a person, so the experience of things doesn't mean quite as much. Well, through the early years of the church, they had great debates over the drama and the art and the images of the church. And so there was a division between the Western Church and the Orthodox Church that all came down to the artwork that would help them in their worship. And so there was what was called the iconoclastic controversy, which ended in the Orthodox Church celebrating only icons, not images. And so if you go to a Catholic church, you will see images, three-dimensional images. But if you go to an Orthodox church, you will see a flat image, an icon, just a two-dimensional image. And those came about by churches and theologians struggling with how to enter into the drama, the color, the experience of their faith. One of the things that is constant through the whole church is the institution and the observance of communion. And again, as we think about that personality type, we could very simply say, well, this is just bread and grape juice. It doesn't turn into anything special or sacred. It's just a symbol to help us remember. And some others would say to us, yes, it is a symbol, but it is a very profound symbol. It is just bread, but it is very holy bread because of the use to which it's committed. And it is just juice, or it may just be wine, but it's much more than that in terms of the meaning that is soaked into it. And so there was a period of time when in church growth conferences they were marketing a quick communion package. And I remember being offended at the very thought, because it was all in a little wrapped, sealed container, the bread and the cup. And the promise was made was that you could take care of communion in 5 minutes, as though we should take care of communion in 5 minutes. Communion is the center of the worship of the church. And as we come to it again today, it's an opportunity for us maybe to go into our type 4 personality and say, what is the drama of communion? What is the color of communion? What is the meaning of communion? What is the experience of communion as we receive what the Lord himself gave to us? And in the night in which he was betrayed, he took the bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, this is my body, which is for you. And after they had eaten, he took the cup, and he said, this cup is the new covenant in my blood. And so we are drawn back into a very powerful meal, Jesus with his disciples. And we come away from that meal with something that he was teaching his disciples then that was for us as well. The drama of the great Easter story, all packaged up in the observance of the meaning of his death and burial and resurrection as we take the bread and take the cup together. So I'm going to invite Dean and Ian, two of our elders, to bring the bread and cup to you. And just as they bring it to your table, let me just encourage you to maybe bow your head, close your eyes, and just pray quietly and ask God to just bring you into the experience of the meaning of communion. And as the song that we just sang said, let mercy draw you near to the meaning of this bread and this cup. And as Bethany leads us in this song, think about the words, listen to the words, sing along, and just at your own pace, take the bread, take the cup, and enter into the color, the drama, the meaning, the symbol of the communion table.
Christ will hold me fast when the
precious in his holy sight. He will hold me fast. Hail, Lord, let my soul be lost. His promises shall last, bought by him at such a cost. He will hold me fast.
The Enneagram is about our personalities. As we raise children or as we are part of families, we begin to discover that we are different from one another. Our kids are different from one another. We had two children that were quite different from each other, so we thought we probably had all bases covered, and the third one would probably be one of the two, and the fourth one would be one of the two again. But the third and the fourth were different from the first and the second, and so you're left looking around and marveling at the personality. Our personality is the way that we interface with our world. That's probably the simplest way to put it. When we moved from Vancouver to Ontario, our children began new schools, of course, and our one son, when he went to school, went to a lovely school just pretty much across the street from where we lived. And so the first day when he came home from school, Annabeth was, you know, doing the mom thing and asking how school was, and she got to the question, did anybody talk to you? No. So Annabeth said, well, what did you do at recess? I just stood there, see if anybody would talk to me. And you saw mom's heart kind of going, oh, my goodness. Second day, I think he came home and Anima said, how was it? You know, it's fine. Mom, what'd you do at recess? Just stood there, see if anybody would talk to me. Did anybody talk to you? No. I think it was the third day he came home and Anima said, so how was school? Typical answer, fine. What did you do at recess? Well, I just stood there. At school today, did anybody talk to you? Yeah, one kid did. And you begin to think, oh, good. But it was just to ask if he could borrow my eraser. Our personality, the way that we interface with the world. Let me bring you to just a bit of an understanding again of how we see the personalities that we all occupy and how they are, in a sense, the fragmented whole personality that we were created with. So maybe if we were to understand ourselves as whole beings, if sin had not come and changed things and changed people and changed us, and we were able to be fully orbed humans, would we be able to sort of travel through the nine types of the Enneagram? And it may well be that the composite of the Enneagram is the perfect personality. Some studies have been conducted on the whole life and behavior of Jesus and how that he, in different times and ways in his life, lived into one or more of the aspects that we see on the Enneagram. So we've seen the first four. We've seen the need to be perfect, the need to be needed, the need to succeed, the need to be special. Then the need to perceive is the one that we'd like to have a look at today. And remember how we understand how these all relate to each other. There's the complicated graph, but here's the simple version. And we're going to look today at the need to perceive. And the need to perceive is also related to a couple of others. Oops, that's supposed to be a straight line. So is that. And the others look like that. So what we've said is that one of these is likely the cabin in which we live. The two neighbor cabins are ones to the left and to the right of the cabin we live in. And we can visit those cabins, but probably not stay there. We'll probably come home to our familiar cabin. That's the box that we typically live in. And in each of the cases, there are two others that are related by these lines and arrows. And when the arrow is facing towards the type we're considering, it's when we're doing well. We're saying, yes, I easily live out into that particular type as well. When the arrow is pointing away, it's what we do when we're not feeling good, when we're stressed, when we're in periods of difficulty in our lives. And so the need to perceive is, as Mary said, exactly the Thomas kind of a need. It's the need to really understand things. It's the need to dig into things. This type is sometimes called the lettuce. Now, here's why it's called the lettuce type. Its heart is in its head. You have to think about that for a minute. Head of lettuce, where's the heart? It's in the head. The one that we saw last week does not have its heart in its head. In fact, its head doesn't really matter. It's heart that matters. The person with the need to be special is one who feels life, who feels relationships, who feels situations, and who is not particularly cognitively oriented around all of the things in his or her life. So the answer to the question, how are you, is an easily answerable question. It might not be a happy answer, but that's a question that the person who is type four can answer quite well. I'm happy, I'm sad, I'm excited, I'm longing, various things like that. Type five, if I were to ask that person, how are you? The person would have to say, well, what do you mean? How am I? In what sense do you want to know how I am? And in what sense can I even respond? In what sense can I sort of articulate how I am? It's a difficult question. Some people have called those who are this type, the need to perceive, as kind of boring. And when one of these particular people was asked about that, he said, I'm boring. Are you kidding me? If you could get inside my head, it is not boring in there. It is talking all the time. It is busy all the time. It's a place of constant, interesting things. I'm not boring. And the person apparently said to this fellow, well, to me you are, which was disconcerting to this person that was called boring. When we are that sort of a person, we really need to let as much of the data come and get sorted in our heads. And probably the best way to describe it is to say, my head really is a busy place. I'm always thinking. I'm always wondering. I'm always trying to figure out. I'm always doubting. I'm always conjecturing. I'm always in process of learning, of becoming, of understanding. So it is usually with an introverted kind of a personality, because the things that are happening in that person's life are happening inside his head or her head. There have been studies done about the reticular activation system and how it's how active it is in extroverts and introverts, and the discovery is that introverts are just bombarded with data that they're trying to process. My dad was an extrovert and my mom was an introvert. My dad could meet anybody, talk to anybody, and things were pretty simple to him. My mom was an introvert and she did not do well in relationships, and she did not do well in really articulating all of the things that were going on inside of her head. I once met with a couple, and they were struggling over the difference between them, and the husband was very extroverted, and the wife was very introverted. And at one point, she looked over at her husband, and she said, I think I've got this figured out. If I were to drop you into a party of 100 people you've never met, you would think you've died and gone to heaven. He said, yes. She said, if you were to drop me into a party of 100 people I'd never met, I'd thought I have died and gone to hell. And he looked at her. He was astonished. And he said, I didn't understand that, till she could really explain it to him. So this one does have to do with those differences in our lives fairly typically. So someone has said that it's not necessary to definitely, you know, land on one of these and say, yes, I know for sure that's me. But rather travel around all nine and see what feels comfortable. We talked about this on Tuesday in our little debrief on Sundays, and the question was asked, do you go into different types at different times in your life? And I think you may well do that. For those who do finally settle in one of the types, there's an experience of both delight and horror at the same time. Delight that in some way, this explains me to me. The horror that this explains me to me when you finally light on one of these. And in terms of a biblical sort of anthropology, we begin to see that the characters of the Bible are wonderfully portrayed to us in full color. The Bible is not a simple text of data, or it's not a theory that's given. It's not a set of doctrines, not a set of theology. It's a set of stories. And they are the stories of people's lives and the stories of people's relationships with one another. The stories of the way that faith and God gets into the middle of people's lives and stories. And then the whole thing is beautifully woven together to tell us the meta-narrative of God's love, God's grace, and God's mercy for us through all of humankind. As we think about the opportunities in the Bible to see things kind of laid out for us, Luke is one of the characters, along with Thomas, who would be a great example of this kind of a perceiver kind of person, a thinker kind of a person. Who was Luke? He was called the beloved physician by the Apostle Paul. Luke was on Paul's missionary journeys. It's thought that maybe Luke was one of the 70 sent out by Jesus. He wasn't one of the disciples, but he may have been one of the 70 that were sent out to do evangelism. Luke was involved in Paul's missionary journey, second missionary journey, third missionary journey, and Paul's final journey to Rome. And Luke was his personal physician, as well as a brilliant chronologer. The Greek of Luke's gospel record and the Acts is said to be the most complex Greek of the whole New Testament. It's almost classical. So the Greek of the New Testament is called Koine Greek, which is a common Greek, everyday Greek. But Luke is almost classical, like the Greek literatures that we have. He seems to have been a brilliant person. He took it upon himself, we might say, to chronicle the life of Jesus and the experiences of the early church. And Luke chapter 1, verses 1 to 4, as we read it together, is a perfect sort of exposure, if you like, or expose of the perceiver kind of a person that we see in the Enneagram. So just listen for that as I read it to you, and we'll just think about this for a moment. Inasmuch as many have undertaken to compile an account of the things accomplished among us, just as they were handed down to us by those who from the beginning were eyewitnesses and servants of the word, it seemed fitting for me as well, having investigated everything carefully from the beginning, to write it out for you in consecutive order, most excellent Theophilus, so that you may know the exact truth about the things you have been taught. That's interesting all by itself. But when you couple it with the idea that this is the sort of person who is writing this, it brings us to just notice and kind of go, oh my goodness, that's exactly how a perceiver would be working this knowledge through and trying to communicate this to others. So we have the gospel record of Luke and the whole record of the book of Acts. Both of them are written to Theophilus. And, of course, we know all about Theophilus, don't we? No, we know nothing about Theophilus. We don't know who he is. Presumably it's he. It simply means lover of God. And Luke writes to Theophilus, and this is the part that the scholars refer to that is the most impressive Greek of the whole New Testament. The words that we find here are the words of cognition, the words of thinking, of compiling, of learning, of communicating, of sorting. He takes upon himself an incredible task of telling the whole story of the life of Jesus and the beginning of the church. The Bible, as I've said to you many times, is such a fascinating work of literature. Why do we have four Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John? Three of them are called the synoptics. That means they looked at the same time. They looked together, syn with an optic. It gives us optician and other optic words. The Gospel record of John is a theology, not a record. The Gospel of Mark is thought to be the oldest gospel, and the comparison between the four gospels is a fascinating one to undertake. And Luke factors in there in giving us the things that, first of all, occur to him as being very interesting and observable. Luke has more stories about miracles and healings than the rest of the gospels. Why is that? Because he's a doctor, he's a physician. Luke has incredible details of geography, and the Acts have the tales of vessels at sea, navigating islands, lands, and because Luke was fascinated with geography, he was fascinated with sailing. So this mind of his along with the gracious work of the Holy Spirit, who quickened Luke's mind to get the right data in place so that Luke could use his natural propensity to study, to learn, to write, to communicate, to compile, to understand, at the end of the day, provides for us one of the gospel records along with the only record that we really have fully about the beginning of the church. There's one piece of literature called the Didache, which was in some ways the teaching of the apostles and another record of what was going on in the early church. But if we didn't have Luke, we wouldn't have the gospel record with some of the details that he brings uniquely about Jesus' life. We wouldn't have the story of the growth of the early church, and we wouldn't have a full-orbed gospel, a full-orbed history of the life of Christ in the beginning of the church. All of it at least tremendously assisted by the fact that Luke uniquely was living in this kind of a personality. He was this kind of a person. He was the lettuce kind of a person who was wanting things to be properly processed and understood. The result of it all, in terms of what he hopes, is at the end of Luke 1, verse 4, where he says, "So that you may know, Theophilus, the exact truth about the things you have been taught, so that you may know the exact truth." One of the wonderful aspects of the human person and the human personality and mind is the ability to keep on learning and discovering. And this kind of a type, this kind of a personality, is the kind that will end up giving lectures in universities, teaching in high schools, teaching in elementary schools, teaching in churches, writing books, putting out ideas, doing scientific research, doing medical research, contributing to our human experience in spades. And it's a provision that God has made that along with the other eight types would all roll together to be a full personality, but has been separated out and leads us to grasping and understanding truth, both biblical truth and scientific truth, and just ordinary truth all around us. Some of the writers that are in the church today are gifts from God, and they have been the sort of people who aren't willing to just accept what has been handed down to them. They're the sort of people that ask the question, why? Or they're the sort of people who push back, like Thomas. Or if you go to the arrow away, they are the kind of people who are able, in the strength of their personality, to be against, to be contrary, to say, no, let's think about that again. Let's think about that still. And in the church, we are continuing to morph into the better version of us that the church should be. And one of the most frightening things is when we reduce ourselves to what we did know, to what we did decide, and what we did write down, and say, now you sign that as well, because if you want to be with us, one of us, you have to subscribe to all of these things. At the same time, people are learning new things. And I've referred many times to N.T. Wright, and he is one of those people who is thoroughly orthodox in terms of what we already did know and believe, but who says, here's another way to look at this, or here's a different emphasis that would be helpful on this. And so we're able to say, okay, that does change my appreciation or my confidence in the things that I'm committing myself to in faith. So that's exactly what Luke was doing. Luke was saying, look, I know there are a lot of stories around, and everybody's trying to tell the chronology of Jesus' life. I have studied this as carefully as I possibly could. And if you want to know my credentials, I'm a medical doctor. Yes, I speak better Greek than anybody else. Yes, but the point is, this is so important that I wanted to write down exactly what happened in the order that it took place, so that Theophilus, anybody who is a person of faith in God, that you will know for sure what went on. If you are this type, you are the type who would feel like you always have more questions. You would think that you're the type that always doubts, always needs to go back to square one and start over and think it through again. And that is a good thing. And to assist that process, this short little passage in Luke is a very confirming passage that says, Theophilus, I wanted you to be sure. I wanted you to know the truth. And so here's what I've written down. So as we, long after the fact, go back and read the Bible, we come to the same conclusion where we accept the stories of the Old Testament, the chronology and the teaching of the New Testament, and we think it through and we press it through and we think about different options and we think about questions and doubts. And then we finally come to the point of faith again, or faith renewed, and say, I still believe. I still believe because there's a careful record. There are careful stories. They've been tested. They've been proven. And for 2,000 years, the church has held on to the truth of the life of Jesus and the beginning of the church that he founded. Theophilus, I just want you to know the exact truth about the things that you've been taught. Is it okay to have questions? Absolutely. And probably the most frequent question that comes to me as a pastor is, how can you be sure? I have all these questions, and is it okay to have questions? We need to say to one another, it is perfectly, perfectly okay to have questions. It's perfectly okay to have doubts. And the reason that we even configured this room this way is to sort of say that there are no questions that are forbidden here. There are no discussions that have already ended as far as we're concerned, because we kind of like the type five that says, the heart is in the head. I need to understand. I need to press through. I need to grasp, and I'm going to keep on working at this until I can grasp it. I think one of the greatest examples of this kind of personality type right now is Jordan Peterson, and it's up to you what you think of Jordan Peterson all told. But his affect, his delivery, his content is this type thoroughly. And because he's always struggling to understand and grasp, he sheds light on things. He comes as a person a little outside of the evangelical faith, so to speak. I'm pretty sure he's in that faith. And because he comes that way, he looks at our faith and our beliefs and our Bible differently. And what he says about them is profound. So you sort it through and you say, well, do I agree with him or do I not agree with him? But he is just a marvel at thinking things through and pressing them to their logical conclusion. One of his most pressing topics is that if there is a God and you declare that you believe in him, wow. He would say, I would be terrified to make that claim, because if you make that claim, it would mean that you do everything that he wants you to do, that you are the thoroughly Christian person that you should be. And so he says what we would say from inside the camp, from the outside of the camp, and says, here's kind of a prophetic word to you. So anyway, if you're looking for a podcast or YouTube to look for this week, Jordan Peterson, worth listening to. He's from U of T, Canadian, just down the road from us. Theophilus, I have undertaken the job of thinking things through, of writing them down with a view to a confirmation of the faith that we have in common. So why don't we pray about this? Father, along with the other personalities, we thank you for the people all around us who are perceivers, who are deep thinkers and observers and watchers and listeners. Father, we thank you for the times that we see the perceivers with those who have the need to be special and how they learn from each other and can reach into each other's style and live into and out from those styles together. We look forward to the day when we will all be complete, when we will all be perfect, when we will all enjoy all of the aspects of the personality that we will have in our redeemed state in the new created heavens and earth. Thank you, Father, for the way that all of these will blossom into our experience and into our community together as Christ is seen and worshiped as our King of Kings and Lord of Lords. In his name we pray. Amen.
Just thought left behind.
one of the ways that Tom Wright has lived into this personality type in rethinking and pressing through is that he has helped us to think about the life after death. And it's an intriguing little phrase. But many of us grew up with notions of heaven being some vague place out there above the clouds with lots of harps and angels. And Tom Wright has talked about the fact that there's a new heaven and a new earth. There is a new creation of all of this. That the real places in this world will be rid of sin, and we will live into God's good creation with all of its provisions. And that excites us a little bit more than playing harps. Although for people who are the need to be special, playing harps is quite all right, in case that's you. When we all get to heaven,